On the day of Maisie's funeral, the weight of grief bore down heavily on her grandfather, Arthur. Each step toward the church felt like a march toward his own demise. Maisie had been his universe, and now she was gone. When he entered the somber sanctuary, his heart ached with the impending farewell. The sight of Maisie's small casket brought him to his knees, tears streaming down his weathered face. In that moment, the world around him blurred. Leaving only Maisie's presence tangible, he stumbled forward, enveloping the coffin in a desperate embrace, his sobs echoing through the silent church. In his anguish, he whispered pleas for Maisie's return, though he knew they were lost to the void. The vicar, ready to commence the service, awaited Arthur's release of the coffin. However, Arthur remained steadfast, his grip unyielding. Maisie's father, Tom, rose with frustration, his voice sharp as he demanded Arthur take his seat. Their strained relationship crackled with tension, exacerbated by recent accusations. However, before Arthur could comply, a jolt of shock seized him. His eyes widened as he declared, hearing a faint cry emanating from within the coffin. Tom's fury flared at his father's insistence, dismissing it as a malfunctioning hearing aid. But Arthur's conviction refused to waver. Panic gripped him as he clung tighter to the coffin, consumed by the thought of Maisie trapped and frightened within. Urgency propelled him to demand the coffin be opened. Now, Tom's anger transformed into a storm of indignation, unable to forgive his father's perceived transgression. However, beneath the anger, lay a father's love for his daughter, mirrored in Arthur's unwavering determination to save Maisie. Even in death, Tom's frustration boiled over, his words laced with scorn when he rebuked his father for causing a scene at Maisie's funeral. "Is this how you choose to utilize your hearing aid?" he snapped, his tone biting with accusation. "Imagining sounds, we should have never bought it." The mention of the hearing aid cut deep, reminder of Arthur's struggle with hearing loss stemming from years of labor in the steel factory. It had been a gift, a lifeline to a world of sound he had long been denied. For the first 7 years of Maisie's life, he had never heard her voice, yet she remained his beacon of joy in a world often unkind to him. Arthur's past held echoes of heartbreak, notably his love for Hazel, whose family disapproved of their relationship due to his modest background. Despite his efforts to win their approval, Hazel succumbed to familial pressure, leaving Arthur shattered and betrayed. Claudia, a friend of Hazel's, seized the opportunity to fill the void left by her departure, eventually becoming Arthur's wife. In his marriage to Claudia and the establishment of a family, Arthur buried his longing for Hazel beneath the obligations of duty and societal expectation. But beneath the surface, the ache of lost love lingered, a silent companion to his enduring grief for Maisie. Arthur's marriage to Claudia was a facade, a hollow shell of obligation rather than love. Despite the arrival of their son, Tom, Arthur could not ignore the chasm that widened between them with each passing year. Resentment festered within him, fueled by Claudia's bitterness and his own unspoken longing for Hazel. Eventually, Arthur reached his breaking point and left Claudia, unable to endure the suffocating misery any longer. Initially, he maintained regular contact with Tom, but Claudia's poison seeped into their relationship, poisoning Tom against his father. It wasn't until Claudia's passing many years later that the rift began to heal, but the scars remained, evident in Tom's tumultuous love life and restless pursuit of fulfillment. Tom's introduction of Becky initially sparked hope in Arthur's heart. Becky's warmth and sincerity seemed to offer a beacon of stability for his son. However, as time passed, Tom's interest waned, leaving Becky adrift in a sea of uncertainty. Desperate and alone, she sought solace in Arthur's counsel, revealing her fears of Tom's infidelity and her own impending motherhood. Arthur's joy at the prospect of becoming a grandfather mingled with anguish for Becky's plight. He pleaded with Tom to change his ways, to honor the love he shared with Becky and the responsibility of impending fatherhood. But Tom's commitment to Becky faltered in the face of his own desires, leaving Becky torn between love and obligation. When Becky confided in Arthur her inability to leave Tom, burdened by the revelation of her pregnancy, Arthur's heart swelled with empathy and determination. He vowed to support Becky through the trials ahead, praying that Tom would find redemption before it was too late. However, beneath his fatherly hopes lay the bitter realization that some wounds run too deep to heal. Even with the arrival of new life, Arthur's heart weighed heavy with grief as he stood by Tom's side in the hospital, bearing witness to Becky's tragic end. Her passing felt like the loss of a daughter, a cruel twist of fate that left him grappling with sorrow anew. Despite his offer for Becky to seek refuge in his home, she had known Tom's intentions to leave, clinging to the hope that Arthur could provide solace for their granddaughter, who was to be named Maisie. However, life's relentless onslaught continued, sparing Arthur no respite. The day following Becky's demise, he awoke to a silent world. His hearing vanished without warning. Years of exposure to the deafening clamor of the steel factory had exacted their toll, leaving him bereft of the one sense he had cherished. The prospect of never hearing Maisie's laughter or her voice shattered him, a cruel twist of fate that mocked his already fractured existence. Amidst Arthur's turmoil, Tom's announcement of his impending marriage to his mistress ignited a fiery tempest within him. Though seething with fury, Arthur suppressed his rage. Unwilling to risk further estrangement from his son, especially now with Maisie in his life, Tom's new wife, Katie, attempted to bridge the chasm between them, but Arthur sensed an unsettling aura about her. Beneath her facade of amiability lurked a venomous contempt, particularly evident in her disparaging remarks about Becky. Despite his hearing loss, Arthur's adeptness at lip-reading revealed Katie's true sentiments. Fueling his disdain for her, Katie's behavior toward Maisie further fueled Arthur's mistrust. In Tom's presence, she assumed the role of a loving wife and stepmother, showering Maisie with affection. However, in moments of solitude, her facade crumbled, replaced by icy indifference toward the child, a stark reminder of Becky's absence. When Arthur's apprehension toward Katie grew, she seized upon his perceived vulnerability, taunting him with plans to deceive Maisie about her parentage. Ignorant of Arthur's ability to comprehend her words, she believed herself beyond reproach, a misconception that would soon unravel in the face of Arthur's resolve to protect Maisie's truth. Becky's presence in the household faded without mention, leaving Arthur startled. He couldn't shake the fact that Becky had adored that little girl from the very start. Maisie deserved to know her mother's story, Arthur felt, determined not to let his granddaughter believe Katie was her mom. Thus, he resolved to share all about Becky with Maisie from the tender age of one. However, Arthur's plans were interrupted when Tom delivered disheartening news. Katie had found their dream home, but it lay on the opposite coast. Losing his son once more was tough, but now losing his granddaughter too felt like another blow. Arthur sensed Katie's scheme to keep Maisie away from him, leaving him devastated. Having seen Maisie almost daily since her birth, she was his beacon of joy. Now, as she grew, he had to bid her farewell. Years passed, and without Maisie, Arthur felt adrift and solitary. Though Tom visited occasionally, it was sporadic, and Arthur missed witnessing his granddaughter's milestones. Amidst solitude, Arthur pondered the twists life had thrown at him. Reminiscing back to Hazel's departure on his 75th birthday, Arthur had assumed he'd spend the day alone, feeling forgotten by his son amidst Tom's life with Katie. However, the unexpected arrival of Tom, Katie, and Maisie bearing gifts and a cake stunned him. Maisie, now 7, seemed like a stranger after so long without seeing Katie. Yet, Arthur hoped that perhaps both Katie and Maisie had changed for the better. When Maisie eagerly opened the box before him, Arthur felt a glimmer of hope for their bond. Arthur heard Maisie mutter something in his ear, and all of a sudden, the world was filled with sound. He heard his granddaughter's voice for the first time ever. It was a song beyond his wildest dreams. Tom gave Arthur the important news that Maisie will be joining them for a few days. It was more than the ideal birthday present for him. Tom requested Arthur to watch Maisie the following day so they could spend some quality time together. Arthur enthusiastically accepted, excited for a day full of play and laughing. Their initial pastime was painting, but things took an unexpected turn. While cleaning the brushes, Maisie raised her gaze and said, "Grandpa, I know Katie isn't my real mommy." Arthur was taken aback. Since Tom moved away, circumstances had prevented him from telling Maisie about her mother, Becky. As he had always wanted to do, he needed to move carefully now. Gently probing Maisie, he attempted to ascertain what had precipitated her admission. Maisie explained that Katie's outburst was sparked by discovering an image of a pregnant woman who looked like her and her father. Maisie begged for confidentiality, but Arthur knew he had to talk to Tom about the matter. Katie had obviously not changed, Tom and Katie surprised Arthur with yet another birthday gift when they got back. But when Katie showed Arthur a picture from a baby scan, Arthur's heart fell. Arthur could not conjure the same delight that Tom felt, knowing that Maisie would soon become less prominent. He found the fortitude to talk to his son about the situation. Katie was not allowed to know what Maisie had told Arthur, so Arthur pretended to be happy while eating, hiding his distress as he wondered how he was going to keep Maisie safe. Tom and Arthur's talk was dominated by his excitement over the upcoming baby when they cleaned up after dinner, but then they both jolted out of their conversation when a sharp scream rang out. From the living room, they raced to the source and saw a terrifying spectacle. With tears running down her cheeks, Maisie lay immobile on the couch with Katie by her side. Overcome with astonishment, Katie tried to explain that before she could help, Maisie had started gasping and stopped breathing. Tom was trying to revive Maisie while Arthur, his voice quivering, called for help, urging them to come quickly. Arthur was not far behind Katie and Tom when they hurried Maisie to the hospital. He had to be with his granddaughter. He couldn't wait to go home. Arthur's aspirations were dashed when a somber-faced doctor entered the waiting room, making time seem endless. The news was devastating. Anaphylactic shock had claimed Maisie's life despite their best attempts. When Becky died, Arthur thought he understood heartbreak, but this pain was unlike anything he had ever experienced. His pain was exacerbated by the persistent doubt that Katie was involved in Maisie's misfortune. Arthur, unable to control his pain, went up to Tom and revealed Maisie's previous disclosure. Tom became enraged and fiercely defended his wife's innocence, accusing Arthur of making unfounded accusations. In a fit of rage, Tom stormed off, insisting Arthur had no idea about their family. In his heart, Arthur sensed that Katie had waited until she was pregnant to orchestrate Maisie's demise, calculating that Tom would simply replace one child with another. Even on the morning of Maisie's funeral, Arthur noticed Katie's red eyes, yet she hadn't shed a single tear since taking her place in the front pew. When Arthur loudly proclaimed he heard a noise emanating from inside the coffin, he observed Katie's pallor, a sign of her discomfort. Tom's sharp retort about Arthur's malfunctioning hearing aids didn't deter Arthur. He insisted he had unmistakably heard something, his conviction unwavering after 7 years of silence. Recognizing his father's persistence, Tom reluctantly agreed to briefly lift the lid to verify Maisie's passing. However, when the lid lifted, Arthur's shout echoed through the church. Small, whimpering sounds emerged from his granddaughter's direction. There was no mistaking it. Maisie was alive. As Tom and Arthur exchanged stunned glances, tears of joy streamed down Tom's face as he embraced his daughter. The congregation hailed it as a miracle, but the astonishment didn't end there. Katie's horrified expression as she bolted from the church alerted Arthur to something amiss. Frantically, he called for someone to stop her, grateful that her pregnant state slowed her escape. Cornered, Katie confessed to poisoning Maisie, believing her dead. However, the toxin only slowed Maisie's vital signs to an undetectable level. Katie harbored a deep-seated resentment towards Maisie, seeing her as a reminder of Becky and longing for a child of her own, hoping to erase all traces of Tom's past life. This story is quite intense, portraying the complexities of familial relationships and the devastating impact of deception and manipulation. Tom's character seems to be one who was blinded by love and perhaps naive to Katie's true nature. His actions, while misguided, stemmed from his desire to create a family and provide a stable environment for Maisie. However, his failure to see through Katie's facade resulted in dire consequences. However, Katie seems to be the adversary of the tale. She is motivated by hatred and jealousy toward Maisie, as well as a desire to remove any trace of Becky. Her malevolent aim is demonstrated by her readiness to hurt Maisie and her lack of regret after being discovered. In general, the narrative emphasizes the value of discernment, communication, and trust in interpersonal interactions. It also emphasizes how resilient family ties are and how forgiving and redeeming people can be. Tom shows development and a dedication to acting in Maisie's best interest by eventually realizing Katie's true nature and making an effort to mend their lives. Regardless of whether Tom was more evil than Katie, it's obvious that their objectives were different. While Katie's acts were motivated by resentment and hatred, Tom's actions were motivated by love and a wish to keep the family together. Even though they were misplaced, but Tom's inability to recognize Katie's deceit does call into question his judgment and discernment in the partnership. That's all about the first story, and now let's watch another similar story, a woman, believed to have perished, shocked everyone when she emerged at her own funeral, vibrant and full of life, surrounded by her 8 beloved children, a devoted husband, and a stable job. Hailing from Burundi, Africa, she could now proclaim that she was living the life she had always dreamt of, despite enduring numerous trials in the past. Leaving her homeland behind, Noelle embarked on a journey to Australia, where she discovered a new home and a promising future. Her days ahead sparkled with hope, envisioning peaceful strolls along Australia's pristine beaches with her husband once their children grew older. Gone were the days of scraping and begging for sustenance. Her husband provided well, and her children were pillars of love and support. However, a trip back to her native land for a significant purpose unknowingly set the stage for a dramatic turn of events in 2004. Noelle Rakundu bid farewell to her homeland in search of greener pastures in Australia. Left widowed with 5 children, she courageously pursued a better life for her family. It seemed her leap of faith paid off when she secured employment and settled into a comfortable life with the aid of a resettlement agency. Welcomed warmly by the Australians, she gratefully accepted the assistance extended to her. Her children adapted seamlessly to their new surroundings, and Noelle counted her blessings, especially when another stroke of luck came her way. Regular visits to the agency, where she once sought refuge, kept her connected to the journey that transformed her life. In the midst of her visits to the agency, Noelle encountered Balanga Kalala, a recent refugee from Congo. With Kalala's proficiency in English, he often acted as a translator for Noelle, who was only fluent in Swahili at the time. Through these interactions, a bond formed between them, leading to unexpected love. Noelle, a widow with 5 children, and Kalala, a widower who fled Congo after a rebel attack claimed his wife and young son, found solace in each other's company. Moved by Kalala's resilience and kindness, Noelle's initial reluctance to remarry dissolved, and she embraced the warmth he brought into her life. Despite her intention to focus solely on her children, Kalala's unwavering support and affection won her over. Their love blossomed, and they decided to build a life together in the Melbourne suburb of Kings Park. Kalala embraced Noelle's children as his own, and in the years that followed, they welcomed 3 more children into their blended family. However, amidst the joys of their union, Noelle began to uncover aspects of Kalala's personality that troubled her deeply. Though Kalala proved himself a diligent provider, his past trauma sometimes manifested in troubling ways. Noelle found herself at the receiving end of his outbursts, particularly when exhaustion or frustration took hold. Despite his remorse after these episodes, Noelle grappled with the emotional toll of their volatile dynamic, torn between her roles as a wife and mother. With their story unfolded, Noelle navigated the complexities of love, sacrifice, and the enduring hope for a brighter future, all against the backdrop of their shared journey from adversity to newfound stability. Despite the challenges she faced, Noelle chose to overlook the instances of strife with Kalala, opting instead to embrace the reality of their relationship. After all, he was her husband, and her love for him outweighed any discord they encountered. In contrast to her life in Burundi, where she was raised by her stepmother, Noelle maintained a strong connection to her roots, regularly keeping in touch with her relatives back home. However, a somber turn of events shook her world when news arrived that her beloved stepmother had passed away after battling illness. Despite the distance and her husband's inability to accompany her due to work commitments, Noelle embarked on the arduous journey from Melbourne, Australia, to Burundi, a trek spanning 7,500 miles. With a heavy heart, she made the necessary arrangements and attended the funeral, bidding a final farewell to the remarkable woman who had nurtured her. Throughout her time in Burundi, Kalala remained a steadfast presence, offering support and reassurance through frequent phone calls. Given the intimate scale of her hometown, Noelle opted to stay in a hotel in Bujumbura, feeling the weight of loneliness, sadness, and exhaustion, compounded by her longing for her husband and children. Following the funeral service, Noelle retreated to her hotel room, seeking solace and rest. Just when she settled in, her phone rang, and she immediately recognized the concern in Kalala's voice. Grateful for his care, she shared her intention to rest, but Kalala, sensing her need for comfort, gently suggested stepping outside for some fresh air. Moved by his thoughtfulness and concern, Noelle heeded his advice, acknowledging the depth of his care amidst her grief. With Kalala's guidance, she found a moment of respite, cherishing the connection that transcended the miles between them. Unbeknownst to Noelle, her steps outside the hotel marked the onset of a nightmare she never envisioned. When she ventured beyond the hotel compound, her tranquility shattered by the sight of a man approaching, she was thrust into a harrowing ordeal. With chilling swiftness, she found herself staring down the barrel of a gun, paralyzed by fear as the stranger issued a stark warning: remain silent, or face dire consequences. Suppressing the urge to scream, Noelle complied, her mind racing with apprehension when she was coerced into a waiting car, surrounded by armed men. She struggled to maintain composure as they whisked her away, her world shrouded in darkness behind a blindfold. For what felt like an eternity, the journey unfolded in eerie silence until the vehicle came to a halt, thrusting her into an unfamiliar, desolate building bound to a chair. Noelle braced herself, her senses heightened as her captors made contact with their elusive boss. Then came the barrage of bewildering accusations, aimed squarely at her. Bewildered and incredulous, she vehemently denied any wrongdoing, grappling with the absurdity of the situation. However, the gravity of her predicament became chillingly clear when the kidnappers pointed to an unexpected culprit, her husband, Kalala. Stunned disbelief gave way to vehement protest when Noelle adamantly defended Kalala's innocence, only to be met with a vicious slap. Her captors, unmoved by her protests, revealed damning evidence of Kalala's betrayal, further shattering her world. With each revelation, Noelle's reality unraveled, her desperate prayers for reprieve echoing in the void of her despair. When the connection was established, the leader of the kidnappers declared triumphantly that they had successfully captured Noelle. The phone was switched to loudspeaker mode, allowing her to hear the voice of the man on the other end. But instead of comfort, his words felt like a stab of betrayal. The same voice that had offered solace just an hour earlier now sounded ominous. This man, whom she had devoted 11 years of her life to, the father of her children, was now condemning her to death. As the kidnappers discussed their plans to end her life and dispose of her body, the taste of death lingered in her mouth, and she blacked out. When Noelle regained consciousness, she realized the hopelessness of her situation, resigning herself to what seemed like an inevitable fate. However, to her surprise, the kidnappers announced that they had no intention of killing her, citing their principles against harming women and children. This unexpected turn of events left her bewildered, unable to fully comprehend the sudden shift in her circumstances. When the leader questioned why she hadn't noticed anything amiss in the past, Noelle struggled to recall any wrongdoing on her part toward her husband. The revelation that her life had been targeted since the previous November left her reeling, unable to comprehend how things had escalated to this point. Despite the danger she faced, Noelle found a glimmer of hope in the kidnappers' refusal to harm her. It was a sign, perhaps, that there was still a chance for her survival. When she spent the following days holed up in the abandoned building, her husband was informed of her supposed demise, and the kidnappers seized the opportunity to extort more money from him. Meanwhile, back in Melbourne, Noelle's brother grew increasingly concerned about her sudden disappearance. With her belongings still untouched in her room, he reached out to Kalala. Suspecting that something dire had befallen his sister, he appealed to Kalala for $545 to fund a police investigation into his sister's disappearance. Without hesitation, her husband transferred the money, expressing deep concern for her well-being. However, his ordeal was far from over. After enduring two harrowing days in captivity, the assassins finally delivered the news she had been praying for. However, amidst the relief, the gang leader issued a cautionary tale, emphasizing her stroke of luck in encountering murderers with a code of ethics. He warned her of Kalala's seriousness, suggesting that others might not share their restraint. Noelle was granted a slim window of 80 hours to flee the country. Before her departure, the leader discreetly passed her a memory card containing recorded phone calls and Western Union transfer receipts as evidence. But his parting words echoed in her mind, a sobering reminder of the dangers she faced and the lessons she needed to learn. With little time to spare, She reached out to her church pastor, Desano Hirono Nangoma, back in Melbourne. Despite initial disbelief fueled by Kalala's deceit, the pastor eventually agreed to assist her. Noel pleaded for secrecy, seeing this as a chance for a fresh start, a redemption she couldn't afford to miss. When she prepared to embark on her new journey, Noel anticipated her husband's reaction upon discovering her survival. In Melbourne, Kalala mourned her supposed demise, portraying himself as a grieving widower to their community. Sympathizers flocked to offer support and financial aid. Unaware of the deceit that had ensnared them all, he appeared shattered, a grieving husband mourning the loss of someone dear. But the facade was crumbling beneath him. On February 22, 2015, Noel returned safely to Melbourne. More cautious and watchful than ever, she learned of the fake funeral her husband had orchestrated, a clever ruse to deceive their community. It was a surreal honor to attend her own funeral. Alive, when dusk settled, Noel sat in a parked car opposite their home, observing her husband escorting the last mourners to their cars. With the coast clear, she seized the moment to unveil her surprise. Stepping out of the shadows, she watched as recognition dawned on his face, his expression morphing from disbelief to fear. Kalala's attempts at speech faltered, his voice lost in the shock of her presence. When she approached, his trembling hand reached out, only to recoil in terror when he realized she was flesh and blood, not a specter. In a desperate plea for forgiveness, Kalala begged, his words mingling with screams of anguish. Noel had forgiven him before, excusing his past violence as scars of his homeland's turmoil, but this betrayal was a breach too far. With a steady resolve, she called upon the authorities she had prearranged, and Kalala was swiftly removed from the premises. Days later, she secured a restraining order against him, fortifying her case with the evidence she had meticulously gathered. Following the officer's instructions, she orchestrated a call to Kalala, unknowingly capturing his damning confession on tape. He confessed to the murder plot, driven by jealousy and fear of losing her to another man. But despite his desperate pleas, Noelle's heart remained resolute, her trust irreparably shattered. With unwavering determination, she pursued justice, confident that the truth would prevail. When Kalala faced official questioning, he adamantly denied his involvement, clinging to a threadbare facade of innocence. But as the interrogation wore on, his resolve crumbled, revealing the depths of his deceit. He initially denied any involvement, insisting he was incapable of such a heinous act. However, when the police played back recordings of his own voice confessing to the murder plot and his motivations behind it, Kalala's facade shattered. Tears streamed down his face as the weight of his actions bore down on him. However, even in the face of his admission, neither Noel or the authorities could unearth the true reason behind his descent into such darkness. All Kalala could offer was a vague notion of the devil's influence, followed by the haunting question of why he had committed such a grievous deed. On December 11th of that same year, the Melbourne court delivered its judgment, sentencing Kalala to 9 years behind bars for his role in soliciting murder. His guilty plea to incitement of murder mitigated his sentence, but even when he was confined to prison walls, Noel found no solace. In the stillness of night, echoes of his voice reverberated in her mind, a relentless reminder of the betrayal she had endured. Healing seemed like a distant horizon, perhaps an unattainable destination. Despite Kalala's admission, some within Melbourne's African community cast a shadow of doubt upon Noel, ostracizing her for her husband's transgressions. For those who had known Kalala intimately, the notion of his culpability was inconceivable. However, amid the whispers of judgment, Noel remained resolute. She bore the weight of her shattered marriage with dignity, finding solace in her unwavering commitment to her 8 children. Though the road ahead seemed daunting, Noel harbored no regrets about her decision to sever ties with Kalala and see him face justice. His unforgivable sin had severed the bonds of trust and love irreparably. While the devastation as a wife was palpable, she drew strength from her maternal instinct, vowing to nurture her children for as long as she drew breath. In the face of adversity and unwarranted judgment, Noel held her head high, embracing the dawn of a new chapter with unwavering resolve. "My past life is gone," she declared, "I am starting anew." Above is today's story. If you like it, please subscribe and give it a thumbs up. See you next time.